What's up? I'm Hyped. On this channel, I already have a video talking about No Limit Records' historic deal with Priority Records. But here's a quick recap.
They said, well, we could offer you a P&D deal, but you'd have to do all the marketing. You'd have to do all the promotion and go through this whole spiel trying to talk us out of doing something like that. And we had said, well, we do all that stuff now. You see us on the Billboard charts. And we had dropped 99 Ways to Die. It was on the Billboard charts higher than some of the albums they had. So they were like, okay, we'll do this deal. They sent over the deal. We signed the agreement. EA Ski had already known, did some stuff with them, and he had a guy that kind of helped out with making sure the paperwork was right. I read the contract. The paperwork looked good. We did 85-15.
There was a moment in history when No Limit Records and Cash Money Records met to strike a deal of their own. Master P's former manager, Tobin Costin, talked about this meeting, saying he, Master P, Baby, and Slim were all present at that meeting.
The Cash Money meeting, I had a relationship. We knew Southwest Wholesale, and we knew some folks that knew those guys. They had already been selling records. In fact, I remember Robert Gillerman from Southwest Wholesale said, hey, at this rate, these guys are going to make over $1 million with me independently. But they wanted to do something national. They were looking to go national. So we set up a meeting. I basically set up a meeting with Baby and Slim and myself and Pete. Now, we had a good meeting. They were not, I think they were, they wanted to do a deal, but they were not receptive to Pete. They just weren't. So for whatever reason, and you know, they're from different parts of New Orleans. So sometimes people from different parts don't really get out like that. And that could have been the situation. So I had talked to Slim and Baby, and they said, well, we like what you're saying, but you know, I don't think we're going to do it. Now, they never came out, you know, and said why they weren't, but they just said, hey, we like how you conduct business, but we're just not going to move forward and do that. Now, I introduced or connected them with Wendy Day because Wendy Day didn't know who they were. And I connected those two. And then Wendy Day kind of took it from there and took their project to Universal. Now, after I split, none of us could get a deal because, you know, P was basically telling folks at Priority, if you do a deal with Cash Money, or if you do a deal with Tobin and me and mine, man, it's going to be problems. So they didn't do a deal. In fact, I had deals all over the table, you know, in New York, in L.A., and those deals would just dry up. And I could find out after the fact that P was basically saying, don't do business with TC because, you know, he's a crook, or he's going to steal money, or he's going to try to overtake this and overtake that, and couldn't get a deal. So the Cash Money thing was personalities, conflicts. They just, you know, they had their own thing and their ego. P had his own thing, and we were doing things on our side, and they decided not to do the deal. And it worked out for them. They wind up doing a $30 million deal with Universal, making a ton of money and moving forward.
Can you tell us, like, what was some of the specifics of the deal that was offered?
Yeah, we were talking about, we were looking for 15%, right? So at that point, it would have been, they would have basically had, it would have been 30% off, because, you know, not quite 30%, because we would have got, you know, our 85%, we're taking 15% of our 85%, and then they're taking the rest. So in the grand scheme of things, not quite 30%, but there's quite a bit of chunk of change that's going to be taken off of that dollar. So they would do all the, they would do all their marketing and promotion. We would do some, like if we were doing tours and things like that, we would bring them along and we would do some songs with them. They would do some songs with us, and we would pretty much try to create this super label, if you will, almost like creating our own major label. So if you think about it, with Cash Money and No Limit at that time coming together, it would have been a game changer. It would have changed the industry. It really would have. And then all we would have need to have done is get, we already had the West Coast and down South because, you know, people knew of us. You get Cash Money and everything that they had and what they had going on in their sound. And then you bring in, we go get an East Coast label or East Coast artist. We literally would control the entire country. And that was really the vision that we talked about. And, you know, the Cash Money thing didn't happen. So they went their own way and P went his own way. And, you know, at that time, we never got an East Coast group or East Coast label. And then by that time, P and I had split us.
As a businessman, do you think that No Limit Records should have had like a lead artist in those later in the 90s? Because kind of like in the Bay, it was Master P as the mm-hmm. premier artist on the label. But when I think about later, there wasn't really that one artist anymore. So the brand had just become just No Limit. So like when it's time for the so-called decline, then there is no one there to hold it up like Lil Wayne kind of did, and maybe even the big timers with Cash Money.
Yes. Well, I think it's important to have someone other than P hold the mantle, because as you get older, no one really wants to, you know, you start to fade. Everyone has this window. This is actually one thing that P said that I agree. Everyone has this 3 to 5 year window of being very, very popular. And when the decline happens, there's a couple things that happen. The sound was kind of sounding the same. The music sounded the same. So if you picked up between 97 and 99, anything that you picked up, a lot of things sound similar, except for maybe one or two projects, right? Or one or two records. So I think you're right. I think there should have been someone else carry on the mantle, whoever that is. P should have probably gone more in the background, started promoting another artist, and really changing how people saw them. And that's the reason why I think that demise, you know, you've got Mac going to jail and C going to jail and Soulja Slim getting killed. And even though Soulja Slim was already off the label, there should have been a way to kind of keep people together, because all the talent went away. And once Beats by the Pound left, it was done. And instead of him trying to, let me figure out how I can let Beats by the Pound be Beats by the Pound and stop thinking about, hey, it's me, I created this thing, and saying, okay, let me stop taking all the control and release that and let folks do what they do best, it would be great. What I find interesting too, there's a lot of people that took money from P. And I find it interesting, the people, someone like myself, and look, King George and I don't agree eye to eye on everything. But one thing I do know, me, and I could speak for King in this situation, we had his back, and we would have never stole anything from him. And in later on, he had folks who were taking money from him, including people who were family members and other people that he put in place. And if he would have had the right people watching his back and really watching what was going on, and also kind of, look, you can guide Master P. He's going to do what he wants to do. But I always had a way of saying, man, we shouldn't do that. That's not going to work. And he was always, he'd be a little bit frustrated, but he would say, okay. He would take a deep breath and listen. But nobody else was telling him like that. They were kind of letting him do what he was doing. So I think if he had another artist and kind of went in the background and just been the executive producer and allow other people to take the mantle, younger folks who really, you know, get it, it would have been better. And the problem is he waited too long, because when Romeo came up, he was doing the kid stuff and everything. It was too late. He had this whole transition. Like, you know, he goes from releasing 28 albums to then releasing 5, you know, and that's a change from a financial standpoint. If you're used to releasing 28 albums, you're going gold and platinum and doing all this stuff. And even records like, you know, not every record he did went gold, like Mr. Servon's album didn't go gold. You know, that was an inaccuracy. They said, oh, Mr. Servon went gold. He didn't. You know, he sold 390,000 records, which is a lot, but didn't go gold. But I will say, if you're in that situation where you're selling all these albums and you drop to 5 albums, and a lot of that had to do with, okay, Beats by the Pounds is not there. You're trying to figure out other producers. You're not being focused on what you need to be focused on. You're trying to play basketball and do all this other stuff. You dropped the ball, lost the sight of what was important. And that's really the key.
Share your thoughts about all of this in the comments, and let me know, who do you think should have been the artist to come out front on No Limit Records? Thanks for watching.